Let's get into all of that by welcoming to our Leon Loft stage, Joe P. Welcome, welcome.
Hello.
What would you like to start with?
This song is called Color TV.
Excellent.
Pick out your face, which one today, what will they say, I say what I mean, to the back of my while I sleep through the week, but I'm upstairs in your room, and you're downstairs dancing. I'll just wait here for you. I'll just keep camping in your bed, build it sand, hold some pillows and pretend we're upstairs in your room while they're downstairs dancing. On the black and white scenes, on a color TV, in a film you won't see. Get what you get, and you don't get upset, so I try to forget that I'm upstairs in your room, and you're downstairs dancing. I'll just wait here for, I'll just keep camping in your bed, build a tent, hold some pillows and pretend we're upstairs in your room while they're downstairs dancing, running out of supplies, trying my best to survive, and all my friends are slowly dying one by one, but it sounds like so much fun. I'm upstairs in your room, you're downstairs dancing, but I'll just wait here for you. I'll just keep camping in your bed, oh, and soon I'll just forget I'm all alone in your
A song from French Blonde.
Yes.
Thank you very much. And before we get to all that, I actually do want to step back a bit. The band that I referenced in the intro called Deal Casino, I want to talk about this because these were buddies of yours, really, going back to the eighth grade?
Yeah, yeah.
When did the band form?
I started playing AC/DC and Led Zeppelin covers in like, you know, we started in like fifth grade, sixth grade, something like that. You know, you get, because it's funny, I don't even know how people start bands, because I think about it and I'm like, when you're in, that's the perfect time. You don't know anything. You just want to have fun. And, you know, that's the thing about like starting music when you're so little is you don't see it as this thing you have to practice. And you in this weird way, you get very disciplined at an early age because you're like practicing this instrument, but it's just a toy to me. Like, yeah. I'm not thinking of it like, oh, like now I see it as like, okay, I got to write a song.
Yeah.
But at the time I was just like, you know, this is a fun toy. Everyone's going to like hang out at parties and stuff. And I'm like, I'm going to write a song, which sounds very sad now that I realize it. But you know, at the time it was just like, you know, hey, we got to have practice on Saturday because we have a show the next day or whatever. And like having that weird, like, mentality that you need to lead a group and let's all get together and like we have this mission we're on. It's weird to do at a young age. So yeah, we just started doing it. And it was just so much, it's fun.
It sounds like what you're talking about, fifth, sixth grade. I mean, it's pure joy.
It
like,
is, yeah.
There really isn't any filter to it. It's just whatever comes out.
It's anything else in sixth grade, you know? It's the same thing. You're just like, oh, nothing is real. I don't know what real life is yet, you know? And I'm still doing the same thing, which is, I don't know if that's good.
But. Well, we can talk about that.
Maybe I'm trying to hold on to that feeling, yeah.
Because first I started doing this, I was 8.
Okay, perfect. So we're good. Yeah. We're both weirdos. Yeah, I love both it.
When did it get serious?
I mean, for me, it was always serious. But okay. I don't know. I always knew, like, this is what I want to do. And I always felt like I was more serious than the rest of the band, where I was, like, the crazy bossy one who was trying to be like, let's stay up till 3 a.m. and let's do this, let's do everything, you know, let's keep working on this. And which, you know, when you love it so much, it's not hard to do. Cause I just love it so much that it's not work to me. You know what I mean? That, if you're someone else who just kind of like, yeah, I'll play bass cause it's fun. It's kind of harder to like stay up till 4 a.m. and work on a song. So, you know, I learned after the band broke up, I learned so much about what it means to be a leader, because at that time in the band, I thought I had to be like a football coach or like a basketball coach, where it's like, I need to be aggressive and be, all right, here's what we got to do. I know you guys are tired, but like, let's stay up and work on this song, whatever. And then after that, it all ended, I realized like the best way to lead is to kind of not lead. Like you just let people do the best version of them and you'll get your best team after that. You know what I mean? And all you can do is be a good example as far as like, well, I'm going to stay up till 3 and just work on this, but no one else has to. And like, you know what I mean? In this weird way, I just kind of figured that all out in like in hindsight or whatever. But it was just, yeah, I don't know. It's, yeah, you start at that age, that's the thing, you're so little, it's all just fun. And then one day it's like, you know, well, we gotta get back home to get to our bartending jobs. And like but the thing is, you're doing the same thing. So that's the kind of classic issue, is where like the thing itself, like I said, hasn't changed. Like this is still like a ridiculous thing to be doing. But it's like, you know, when you're little, it's like fun and crazy and carefree. And then as things in real life start to come up with it, it's just like some people can hang on. Some people are like, this is crazy.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, it's not. But you know, yeah.
I know that too.
Yes.
Many conversations with family.
Yes.
Family and friends.
Someone, Thanksgiving, great time.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Great time.
So AC/DC, Zeppelin, got it.
Mm-hmm.
Totally get that. The first time you thought you actually had something to write about that was actually coming from you, what was that about?
A girl.
Okay.
I mean, it was just a girl I liked that didn't like me. And I was like, it was called It Is What It Is, which it was so sad. It was like, it was just like all this stuff about like how I love you, but I guess it is what it is. Like it was, I don't even think she ever heard it, but that was the first song I ever wrote for real. And I was like, all right. I could still remember it. So it wasn't that bad, but it was just like, yeah, it was the first time I felt, I must've just had that first feeling of like, I feel something and I want to get it out of me. And I just did that. I didn't think too much. Again, you're still at the age where you're like having fun. And that was probably eighth grade. So like, you know, you're still that carefree kid thing, but I was doing this very serious thing where I'm like, dealing with my emotions in eighth grade. You know, like that's what's weird about when you're a musician or an artist or whatever, or a songwriter, because like I said, you do these things at an earlier age than all your friends who are like, we're just having fun and like playing football or whatever, right? And I'm like thinking about my life. Just weird stuff like that, I think about it now. I didn't know at the time, but yeah, I haven't changed. Like I still, that process is the exact same process as now. It's like, my best songs come from that feeling of like, I want to get this out of me.
Yeah.
And I never know it. I never am aware of it. So that hasn't changed. But yeah, it's weird.
And when you say that, well, I was thinking about my life. Like we all sort of chuckled uncomfortably.
Sure,
but that's
sure.
what we should all be doing.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah. Not in eighth grade. No one do that. That's in eighth grade. Bad.
What do you want to do next?
You know what? I'll do a Bruce cover. For
sure.
It's like 7 a.m. for me, so I'm still waking up, by the way. So.
Girl, is your daddy home? Did he go and leave you all alone? Oh no, I got a bad desire. Oh, I'm on fire. Tell me now, baby, is he good to you? And can he do those things to you that I do? Oh no, take you high. Oh, I'm on fire. Oh, I'm on fire. Sometimes it's like somebody took a knife, baby, edgy and dull, and cut a 6-inch valley through the middle of my skull. At night I wake up with the sheets soaking wet and a freight train running through the middle of my head. Oh no, can you cool my desire? Oh, I'm on fire.
You're listening to Ann Arbor's 107.1. We are live at the Leon Loft here, and we are talking to Joe P. And I wanted to ask you, so, you know, this pandemic period forced all of us to sort of reassess a lot of things. A lot of things came out. You were speaking to some of the things you discovered about yourself as leader and then working alone. And you were working alone, and it allowed this sort of new thing to emerge. Was it easier or harder not having gigs to play, not having deadlines, not having rehearsals? Or was it harder that you had to impose all of those deadlines to work on yourself?
It was pretty funny, actually, because in the band, I was like the songwriter, you know, crazy guy staying up till 4. But the guy who played like guitar and keys and stuff was the like answer emails guy. He like went to UPenn for material science. Like, he's really smart. And then the other guy was the like, you know, I don't know. Everyone had like their role kind of thing. And that was kind of the reason we ended, was like all those roles went away, because when the world shut down, there was no longer shows. It's funny. People think of touring and music videos and all these things as like, you know, like, oh, that's what you do in a band and everything. But the thing is, they're all like distractions in this weird way. Like, when you go on a tour, I see it now as like a vacation in a weird way, where it's tough and it's grueling or whatever you want to call it, but you're just waiting around all day and then playing for 45 minutes or whatever and then getting off stage and doing the same thing again. And by show 3 or 4, make no mistake, that artist is like an autopilot, and it's the greatest thing ever, because then you have fun. But it truly is like just a, it's like the eighth grade talent show every night, you know, which was, it was fun, but it's not that much work. You know, you're not writing as much as people say you'll write on the road, unless you're in a tour bus and you can do that. You're not really going to do that. But you, it takes like a month out of your life of creating in a weird way. So, but the thing is, it feels good. It feels like you traveled, you literally progressed. So it's a very like instantaneous feeling of like gratitude of like, okay, look, there's people here. We played, we sold merch, whatever. And all that went away. And you have to now be left alone with how much do I love just this music that doesn't exist until I make it exist, you know, which is, there's nothing there. You have to love sitting there and getting nothing every day, you know? But, and that's what happened with the band. It was like, everyone looked around like, well, what do we do now? You know? And I was like, what do you mean? There's so much to do. Like I was having so much fun sitting in a basement every day. And I was like, the rest of the world doesn't think I'm crazy anymore because I can't go to the beach when people invite me to the beach, which I loved because no one was doing anything. And there's no parties. There's no weddings or events to go to. I loved it. It was the greatest thing ever. So I was no longer crazy for staying inside like during the summer. It was like great in a basement, hiding from the sun. But, you know, like that's, I mean, for some people that was like a nightmare. And for me, I was like, this is what I always wanted. You know?
Yeah, your purpose didn't change. Like their purpose all changed.
Exactly.
There weren't a lot of emails to answer.
Right. Right. There's no emails. There's no like, you're the bass guy on tour that you feel like every night you're doing something. That's gone. And, you know, I can write all the bass parts and record them and stuff. So that takes that away. And it's, but at the same time, when things started kicking back up, it was like, I have to do everything now. Like I have to answer those emails and like wake up on time to get somewhere or whatever. As I got here late today. but it's funny. I quickly got good at it, but I also, it was like one of those things where it's like when you're, you know, your girlfriend, whatever goes away for me anyway, it's my girlfriend. When she goes away and I'm home alone, I just watch the house crumble to shambles as far as like, not, you know, it's just like, I watch my clothes pile up in like a ball. And it's not because she would just grab them and do those or anything like that or put them in the hamper or something. But like, she's like the only person I care about who thinks of me. And I'm just wearing like sweatpants and I'm like, what? And I just start eating poorly. And I'm like, when are you coming home? Like, this is bad. This is not good. I'm not supposed to be alone. This is not the right thing. But it's one of those things where when the band is over, I realized all these things that I was like, oh, that someone needs to do that. I need to do that now. And even our manager, I was never close with our manager and he's still my manager today. But it was kind of like this awkward thing of the band ended and all of a sudden I like pick up my phone and it's Pergo, which is his name. And I'm like, hello. He's like, hey man. I was like, hey. He's like, so what's going on? I'm like, I'm going to keep doing this. As just myself. He's like, okay, you want me to still be like your manager? I was like, yeah. And I was like, all right, I'll see you. And now I talk to him every day, like 100 times a day, you know, like it's so much, but it's funny. And it was like, but again, I learned so much so quickly right after that ended, because it was like, not that I didn't like him as a manager, but I was just like, oh, he's always like bothering us with the like stuff I don't want to care about. Cause I just want to be the creative guy. And now, though, I realize it was like I never talked to him, so he didn't know what I liked or wanted. Now, I've talked to him so much every day, that's how you get someone to, you know, it's literally like a bad relationship. It's usually because of communication. Like, I was communicating with him so much more often that I started being like, oh, he gets what I'm thinking before I think it now, and you get a better end result. Again, like how to be a leader. It's like, you don't not talk to someone and you don't, you know, you don't boss someone around. It's just like, you just let people do their thing and talk to them, you know? So I just learned a lot overnight where I was like, okay, I'm gonna have to do all this, but it's not that hard. You just have to like know it's, and you also, I had no choice. I was like, okay.
Yeah, right.
So I was kind of thrown right into it. Like, all right, write the songs, but also answer that email. Yeah.
So I do want to bring this up. I usually loathe talking about visual on radio. It's hard, but sure. I really do have to talk about this with you because of all the ways to stand out that I have seen over the many years of doing this show, I have to say that this film called If We Run, as a way to introduce people to four new songs in a 30-minute horror slasher film where the songs are just sort of part of the thing, and directed by your bass player, Tony. Okay. So, brilliant. Just brilliant. Like, this is, it really is, it's a great watch. I'm not even a fan of the genre.
Yeah, me neither. Actually, that's what's so funny. I'm terrified of horror movies.
Yeah.
But I think it was like how I conquered it. Where I was like, I'm going to make one. Because then I can't get scared. You can't scare me if I'm the one who wrote that part where the guy jumps out.
Yeah.
So I kind of loved that. But yeah, it was just a result of, I've made so many music videos. So it's funny you see my bassist, Tony, because he's really like the director. Like in that other band I was in, it was all, he did every video ever as a director and shot it. And same thing for my project. And I, when it came time to like go on the road, I was like, I don't have a band anymore. I don't know what to do. I was just like, hey man, you're like my last friend. Well, you got to play bass. I know you can kind of play bass. He's like, I don't even own a bass. I was like, I'll get you one. It's going to be great. So, you know, he's just like also the bass guy. It's kind of funny now. He's become that. No, but we have made everything together and we just go get pizza, very New Jersey style, go sit down, get pizza and come up with ideas all day. And music videos are great, but you only get about 3 or 4 minutes to kind of do something. You don't get that much time. Plus the medium is very like, you got to lip sync the song. You got to do whatever. There's no time to stop and talk and act something out. I was like, what if we did a horror movie, which is his world? Like he was great. He's great at that. So I was like, what if we do that, but cut in these 4 live performances in the movie, but almost make it part of the movie. So like the girl runs in the house and it's like, we made it so that it's not just like this weird thing where a band's playing in the corner. It's like, oh, it's on the TV as a Tonight Show performance. Yeah. So like we had to go shoot a Tonight Show performance somewhere, which was so depressing, like pretending I'm on the Tonight Show. But I had to do it. But you know, we did that and like that just plays on a TV. So it was like, there's so much detail going on in that. And the cool thing about like pitching that to like the label, as far as like, give me money to do this, was like, I can still cut it up into 4 music videos. We'll just take, you can still have 4 separate videos of just the song portion of it and remove the movie context. Mm-hmm. But the movie itself is like, it plays all the way through and it just, it goes with like the kills and like fun stuff. Yeah, it's so much fun.
And that music, the music that you put in there that you chose to do for this, it works well with that. Like in other words, if you tried to do a 30 minute rom-com,
exactly,
these songs would not have
horror worked. Is the only thing I realized. It's the like blood, guts, rock and roll is like great together. And I think it's just because horror like just lends itself to like the word cool. Like it is cool. That's what's weird about horror. It's always had this thing where even if you're afraid of it, or love it or whatever, it just has a thing about it where it's like when you think of like a, you know, whoever, you know, Michael Myers, whatever, there is still like this cool thing about it that it's because it scares you, you almost are kind of just like, you know, you're just kind of like at its mercy, which is, I don't know, it's kind of, which is like rock and roll. Like when it's good, you just, it's there.
Yeah.
It's happening to you.
Well, I'm still not a fan of the genre, but me now either. When people say, what's your favorite horror film? I'll just say, If We just Run.
Yeah,
have
you too.
Seen it?
Yeah. That's the only one I'll watch. Yeah. I'm like, watch this one. I'm going to do a song called Kids in the Summer.
All right.
Yeah.
Summer.
to have a million ways to hide. Now all we ever do is run. Sell all we know, trade skin and bones, till nothing's left of anyone. Till it doesn't hurt, start all over again.
Thank you.
Hey, listen, we are going to go back to the station now, but we will continue on here at the Leon Loft with Joe P. That new EP is called French Blonde. It's on mm-hmm. Atlantic Records. You can also watch that movie we were talking about, If We Run, and hear more and see more by going to joepthehyena.com.
Yeah, all the other Joe P's were taken, so.
Yeah.
I just said, my manager, speaking of him, was like, just pick your favorite animal or something. So I was like, okay, cool, that's it. So.
joepthehyena.com.
Yeah.
All right. And now it's back to more music on Ann Arbor's 107.1. Good?
Sweet.
All right. Fantastic. Now it's just us.
Wow.
It's just us and the artist and the cookies. Are they gone? I have more if they're still there. Are they out?
No, they're not.
Ugh. All right. That's fine. You forgot to pass them? Oh, you got to pass them. All right. Not a big eater crowd. That's fine. All right. So you're working away. You're in your studio, basement studio, and you know, lots of freedom, and you get to try all these ideas. But ultimately, really, the goal is to get back to doing this, to getting out and doing live performance. Right?
Definitely. Yes.
So, what was sort of the touring parameters of Deal Casino? Was it East Coast?
We did everything at one point, but it was like, you know, it was always opening slot for sure, but it was also like, I don't know, it's touring is cool, but it's not worth it in a lot of ways anymore until it's a certain point of number of people willing to come see you, because the idea of going out there and playing and like, oh, look, 15 people were there, and then next time, oh, there's 25 people.
Right.
It's like, people would always say that to me as like, that's what you got to do, and I was like, based on that model, I'll be like 100 years old, and then it'll be like, okay, there's 1,000 people or something. You know, it's like, this just seems crazy as far as like how long that would take and the amount of time and effort and money you spend doing that. It's like, by the end of that, you'll just not like doing it anymore. Mm-hmm. So, but again, it was like, that's what you do to feel good. Like you feel like we got to go out and play. That's what you do it for. You start playing in a garage, so you want to go play music. So it's just hard because you can't get people to show up unless the internet knows about you a little bit, or they have streaming numbers happening. And so, you know, it was good. But again, that's what I think kills a lot of bands is like, they try to do that to build at the same time. And it's like, you'd almost be better off doing what the Beatles did and just stay put, stay in a studio and record and record and write and write and write. And like, when it's time, go out when people are waiting for you to go. And I think it's important to play shows because that's the thing I think is happening right now where a lot of overnight success situations are happening via the internet and TikTok and Instagram. And it's like, you go see these people play and they have no show experience. Like, they haven't played for no one before.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and like, that's part, that feeling of like, there are so many weird miniature situations that you should go through in order to play a giant place. You need to know what it feels like to play in the corner of a room when people are talking and they're almost mad at you for playing. Yeah. And you're sitting there pouring your heart out about that girl in eighth grade that you broke up with. And it's just like, you need to feel that. Like, you got to feel that feeling, because one, that's what proves to yourself that you love doing it, is that you're not doing it for people to go, you're so good. You know, right. You're doing it because you love doing it and you're willing to go through the worst of moments and feelings and like humiliation to just be able to do this thing. And then when you get those things, when those people turn around and they listen to you, it's so much sweeter, because you're like, oh wow, I remember when people hated when I played in the corner of the room. You know what I mean? So, but you also just, it's like, not to bring up Bruce again, because it's so funny. I grew up in North Jersey and never listened to Bruce Springsteen. And then moving to like Asbury Park, when everyone talks about it, I was like, okay, I'll give him a shot. Went to a show and I'm like, oh, he is so good. Like, it's the best show ever. And he's like 70, right? I go see him play, he plays for 4.5 hours. And it's so good. And there's no light show. There's no tricks. And I was like, that's everything you need to... He had to play a million shows to be able to do this moment. You can't just get up and do that because you have a popular song.
Right.
It doesn't happen. And the issue is, people are going and seeing these viral artists. And they go and they see them and it's like, play that one song. Okay, they did it.
Right.
And they didn't even do it well because they don't have the experience. It's not even their fault. They're just being pushed out to go play these things because people will come see you. And then people walk out like, okay, well, I don't need to see that person ever again because I got that out of my system. I went and witnessed the big viral thing. Yes, the song.
Yeah.
And now I don't need to see that anymore. And it's like, that stinks for those people, because it's like, you know, it's not their fault.
It's sort of bad on both sides. Like, there's no 10,000 hours thing for the artist.
Yeah.
They're not getting that benefit. Right. And then the audience is saying, I saw the song, song's over.
Yes.
And they can have a 20-year career going, and the person's going to go, oh, yeah, I saw their song.
I don't want to come back. And why would you come back and see them based on their, like, not good performance? That's the thing. It's like, again, they just haven't gotten to the point where they have done that, where when you get to that point the right way and you play, it's like everyone's going to come back and be like, every song, that show was great. Oh, my God. Like, you should make those people, like, freak out and want to come back as soon as you come back there, you know? But it's, you know, you have to work on that.
Is it harder to front your own band rather than fronting a band that you're in?
I don't know. No, I think it's scarier. It was a little scary, like my name being, because I'd always make fun of people like Dave Matthews Band and all that stuff. I always made fun of them, and little did I know there was a whole plan in store for me. But yeah, I would always just feel like, oh, it's so like, gotta be so scary and whatever. But also, I do like it better, because there was something about a band where I always felt this need to be a character within the band. I wanted to sing like I imagined people listening to my band, the way I listened to the Strokes or the way I listened to like Led Zeppelin or something. And like, how do I be those characters? You know, how do I be the singer that everyone loves or whatever? And you sing a certain way and you act a certain way. I didn't know it, but I kind of did that. And then with this, it was like, it's just me. So I walked out and I can do no wrong in the sense of like, I'm not going to try to be cool. I'm just going to do whatever I can do. And if people are like, that was cool, okay, cool, thanks. I don't know, it's just me.
Right.
Whereas with the band, I felt like I had to go out there and be a thing, which was freeing and fun to learn that feeling of becoming something on stage. But it wasn't the thing I was supposed to be becoming, if that makes sense, on stage. It's like whatever I do now is the way I feel good about, because when people are yelling, Joe, after the show, it feels different than like, hey, that guy in that band, come here, like that was a good show. It's just a different feeling. It doesn't feel as, there's not as much ownership in it when it's the band, I felt like. And that's what I loved about the band. That's my favorite thing, is like, what's cooler than like, you know, the Clash and like the Kinks, where it's like this force of nature of like four people doing something. Like, that's the coolest thing to me, because it is so hard to do. I think that's what I realized now. It's like, I love it because it's so hard to like have that perfect chemistry and people just get it when they hear the song and see the show or whatever. But it just wasn't meant to be that, you know? And that's what I think also pulled away from the band, is I would be like, guys, I wrote a song and like I wrote all the parts. Like I'm not trying to, I just did it by accident. And then they'd be like, oh, thanks a lot, you know. And then it's weird, you know, you get weird feelings. And then I'd be like, no, okay, you can write the part. Because then it becomes like, I'll sacrifice the art for my friends to feel good, mm-hmm. which is cool. But again, like that's, it's so hard to balance that world of like, how do you say, guys, I wrote the bass part, it's good, you can try, but if mine's better, we should go with mine. Without someone being like, listen, man, I knew you in seventh grade. Like, I'll beat you up. You know what I mean? Like, it's not like an office job or something where like there's all these regulations of like, well, you have this position, so you get away with doing this and whatever. Yeah. It's like, no, man, I like, you know, and everyone has a mood. It's like being in a relationship with three different people at once. It's really what it is.
Yikes.
And you need to know how to balance. That person didn't eat yet, so that's gonna mean they're angry about this thing, and it's just a lot. You have to go through a lot more, which again, I give so much more credit to why bands I think are so impressive, because when they work, it must be such a magic moment. I mean, the Beatles were like 6 years, because they made all that music in like 6-7 years, and mm-hmm. it's like, because they were probably just gonna explode at the end, which as we learn and read about it, that is what was happening. They were just like, I can't do this anymore, you know, and they all went their own ways. So yeah, that's true. Yeah.
All right.
Drugs were involved, and yeah.
Wow, this is a blast. What do you want to do next?
I don't know. Tune really quick. Hang on.
Sure.
Okay, it's okay. Okay, yeah, this song is called All Day I Dream About, because Adidas wouldn't let me name it Adidas's. So I had to do this. But it's fine, I like it better.
She feels exactly like the weather in December in New Jersey. She paints her nails a different color so her mother doesn't worry. Dancing all alone on her tippy toes, New Year's Eve. She feels exactly like the weather in December in New Jersey. And she said, this year I think I'm gonna be a ghost on Halloween. Cut holes so I can see. Bring all my candy home to you, so you get a cavity in your tooth. Then my heart won't be so easy to chew. You and your Adidas is in love with them in New York. I crossed out the Gucci and wrote your name on my t-shirt. Lips blue, turning 22 in the hotel room. Oh, you and your Adidas is in love with them in New York. And she said, this year I think I'm gonna be a ghost on Halloween. Come home so I can see. Ghost on Halloween, cut holes so I can breathe. Bring all my candy home to you, so you get a cavity in your tooth. then my heart won't be so easy to chew.
Thank you.
Another great video, by the way, for that song.
Joe P. the Hyena,
if you want to see all of these. Finally, because, time's tight. I mentioned Asbury Park. You moved to Asbury Park, and, you know, the legends haunt the streets. Stone Pony is still there. I was actually surprised to see that is actually
almost
still
everything
around.
Is still there. All the venues, cool. Wonder Bar. Yeah, it's crazy.
But what is the scene like now? What is that music scene like now?
Well, it's like any other, you know, cool town, especially in a state like New Jersey where there's not much cool happening. But it got pretty gentrified as far as like one side of the railroad tracks has become like condos and, you know, all that stuff. So the venues and all the cool things are there, but it's like a cover band, and like it's not as much like the owners of the bars want to give people chances, and they just want to, like, you know, it's all tourists now on the weekend, so let's get a Bon Jovi cover band and make a lot of money, right. Which is fine, let them go, let them do their thing, but it kind of changed a little bit from where it was like anywhere you went it was all just like the local band, maybe a touring band or something like that, but there's just too much. I'm sure like all of their mortgages or rents or whatever have gone up at all the clubs, so they got to pay the bills and like, let's get the Bruce cover band, you know? So
when they give away the awards, when they do that, they're giving them to people who are performing where? Like, how do you find the cool upcoming music in the Asbury Park scene?
In Asbury, now it's different. I really don't know of any bands in the scene anymore. Because it started like New Brunswick, which is like Rutgers University, would do these basement shows, which were, thinking back, so dangerous because you cram all these people into a basement, you charge them $5 for a solo cup so they can drink out of the keg, and we would play, like our band, like whoever would show up, and like four bands would play, a touring band would play and get all the money from the cup. It was so silly. But it was like, you're crammed in these unfinished, terrible basements. The PA system is like, it sounds terrible, and it was insane, but it was a lot of fun. Gaslight Anthem was a band that came out of that, the Front Bottoms. There's a lot of bands that have come from that kind of DIY thing that Jersey has been so good with, as far as like, there's so many places you can go play. In North Jersey, there were all these VFW halls I could play, like in high school and things like that. And Asbury, has just really, really recently become more of like, we need like a band to play for 3 hours and they're gonna have to do covers. Right. And here's a bucket, like Nashville, like on Broadway.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the same mentality, I think. I think they're trying to become more like, let's get money in here, you know? Mm-hmm. So kind of lost its spark a little bit, but it's still cool.
Well, thank you for spending time with us today. We have time for one more if you have one to play.
Yeah,
what do you want to do?
This is Off My Mind.
Okay.
Think of ways to tell you I'm fine. One more vodka soda, then you'll never even know that I'm lying. I used to wonder why you never said goodbye, but now you're off my mind. Myself another lover, God, I love her, I'll never stop. Take her out and drive around and show her all of our favorite spots. I used to sit and cry. I felt like I could die. But now you're off my mind. Ooh. And we'll be better by the summer. You'll come out. making toast in that tub with all my ducks in a row, wearing all of my clothes. I still put my hand around the headrest in my undercoat. But no one's there to hold on to the wheel while I let go anymore. You're every car that passes by, every blonde hair in the corner of my eye. But now you're all of my mind, I can't believe what they're saying. You don't live in Jersey anymore. You went to fight off your genetics, you heard the West Coast had the cure. Now you watch the kids grow up while you're just getting old. You used to be so sure, and now you never know. But it's okay, yeah, it's I'm too far from you to fall in love tonight.
This is the revenge song for the eighth grade girl, I just realized. Wow. It just hit me.
And we'll be better by the summer. You'll come out from underneath your
guys. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Joe P, ladies and gentlemen.